So today we are going to start with programmable interrupt controller IC number 8259. Now here this word is very important because it is programmable. So definitely we can program this IC in different modes. It can work in different ways depending on the type of programming we do on this particular IC. And especially this IC is dedicated for handling interrupts. Okay, so we can program this IC to handle different interrupts in different types of modes and with different features. So it is quite a very, it is very so-called useful IC. And definitely when you are trying to interface many devices with 8085, then in that case, all these devices must be able to communicate with 8085 with different priorities. And for that, this particular IC is used because 8085 or microprocessor or any other microprocessor system, whenever the designer designs the microprocessor system, he avoids polling. Okay, I believe you understand or you know what is polling. So mostly the designer tries to design the whole system based on interrupts. Okay, whether he is using 2 devices or 5 devices or 50 devices along with the 8085 or any other microprocessor, the designer always try to design the whole system using interrupts. Okay, so this IC is very important from that point of view. So let us talk about the polling technique and how the polling technique handles multiple devices. When we are saying multiple devices, you just can assume it like this. For example, you have 8085. Okay, you have 8085. And suppose you have a keyboard. Then you have a printer. Suppose you also have an alarm button, alarm switch. Okay, then you have a beep for the alarm. Then you have suppose a USB drive. Then you have LCD display or something like that. Okay, so there are so many things which can be connected to 8085. Now the question is, 8085, how the 8085 is going to communicate with all these devices and which device will have a higher priority compared to the other devices, and how 8085 can handle all these particular issues. So for that, the solution comes up with an IC which can interface between these peripherals and microprocessor. So microprocessor will communicate only with the peripheral IC, okay, the PIC, programmable interrupt controller, PIC 8259. There are other PICs also, but we are studying 8259. So this, all these peripherals will be connected with the PIC, and PIC has got all the features to manage all these devices in different modes and different with all different features and priorities. Okay, so therefore when we are talking about polling technique, in that case what happens, all those devices that we talked about will be given some time. Okay, and according to that time we will be scanning these devices, and all these devices will have a small time period in which they can communicate with the microprocessor. For example, here we have the main program. Okay, and suppose the main program is written, and then suddenly you call for a subroutine, and the subroutine is called for the device 1, DEV1. Okay, so device 1 requires 8085 control, or suppose it needs the data bus or any other resources from the microprocessor. In that case, suppose we call the device 1, and the device 1 jumps to a subroutine. Okay, remember this is a subroutine. So this is the main program and this handles the subroutines. Okay, so subroutines, so suddenly from the main program you jumped to a subroutine, and now the subroutine calls for an interrupt service routine. For particular device you have an interrupt service routine, so again it jumps from the subroutine to, you can call it subroutine or you can call it interrupt service routine. And interrupt service routine, you wrote some program, and after that definitely when you have call definitely call will end up with return. So return will jump here, the program completed, okay, for device one, right? And then from here it jumps to exit, assume exit one. We are calling it exit one here, okay? Exit one. So he will jump here and then it will return from here to the next line, which is here, okay? From the interrupt was called. So the program will return here. Then after some time, the next call comes for the device two. So device two will jump again to the subroutine. From there it will jump to the interrupt service routine, and then when it is returned it again jumps to exit and you return back. Again when you return, remember this time the return will not go here, this time the return will go to the next line from where the device was called. So in this way the program will keep on jumping from one location to another location to another location. So basically in this technique, assume there was a pulse generated here at time t0, okay, and this event is happening before time t0. But unfortunately when this particular loop is going to be executed, assume that this loop takes more than required time and it exceeds t0. For example, we started our system at time t equal to 1 second, okay? When our system started at 1 second, suppose this part took 0.5 seconds, so total time elapsed is 1.5 second, and then you entered into a loop, or we can say subroutine, and this part, only this part which is red here, this part took suppose 3 seconds. Okay, though these times are very large time compared to 8085, the so called crystal, we are taking it for simplicity. So assume this took 3 seconds, but there was a pulse which was generated from device 2 at 2 seconds. Okay, so because the microprocessor was busy in this particular subroutine till 3 seconds, so the total time it took was 1.5 second was elapsed here and then 3 seconds here. So the program will reach to this point at 4.5 second, right? So 1.5 second wasted here in this part, then 3 seconds wasted here in this part, and the program or the microprocessor reached to the input C2, that means reading the port C2 at 4 seconds. But at 2 seconds there was a pulse, and this pulse ended at suppose 3 seconds. So this pulse was high for only 1 second. Okay, so now when the program tries to read the pulse, he will find that there was no pulse because the pulse is gone. Okay, now he sees, okay, there is only zero. In such cases, the proper response for device 2 is missed. Why? Because the microprocessor was busy in some other task. So now the question is, using these techniques, it is very easy that we can see that some crucial events can be missed due to the scheduling of different tasks by the microprocessor. And because the microprocessor was busy in some other task. So definitely this particular technique is not good. So this technique is basically polling technique, from jumping to one location to another location, and indirectly the microprocessor is busy doing some task based on the program itself rather than the importance of the device or the importance of any particular event. So this technique is not good at all. Okay, this technique requires very simple programming, but with this technique we can never achieve a quality program because we will lose many important events in between some even sub in some sub routines. Okay, so definitely polling technique is not good. So to avoid polling technique, we generally uses interrupt based techniques. So what are interrupt based techniques? In interrupt based technique, we will give priority to different devices, and depending on the priority of the device, we will, or the microprocessor will give all the resources to those devices which have higher priorities. Now let us come to 8259 and see what are the features of 8259 and how can we use it. So the first few things that we have to remember is 8259 can handle 8 different interrupts. Okay, it can handle 8 different interrupts. So that means if you are using only one 8259 IC with 8085, then you can connect 8 different devices. How? Okay, so you will have your 8085, which is your microprocessor, and you have one 8259. So since there are 8 different interrupts which can be handled by 8259, it means there will be 8 different pins for 8. Okay, so 1, 2, 3, 4, and 8. So it can handle 8 different devices, and you can connect 8 different devices here. Device 1, device 2, and so on up to device 8. Okay, so and 8085 will communicate only with 8259, not with the devices directly. Clear? So whenever any device want to use the resources of 8085, or whenever the device wants to use some facilities from 8085, in that case first the device will communicate to the 8259, and 8259 will operate in between 8085 and the device, and he will manage all the features of interrupt and all those stuffs. So 8259 can handle 8 different interrupts. When we say 8 different interrupts, simply it means we can connect 8 different devices, keeping in mind if we are using only one 8259 IC. If we are using only one 8259. Now, I will come to that later, okay? Okay, it provides interrupt to INTR pin of 8085. So how these interrupts are actually handled or passed to the 8085? So for 8085, you remember, you might be recalling that there are interrupts like RST 7.5, 6.5, 5.5, and then you have one more line called INTR. Okay, so these are all input pins. Okay, so and then of course there was one trap also. So what is the difference between the interrupts on the left side, which are shown here, and this particular interrupt? What is the difference between these two types of interrupts? The interrupts which are shown in the left side or in the left circle, and the interrupt which is shown in the right circle. What is the difference?
Sir, for INTR, we have to provide with the address where our subroutine will be written. And for...
Any other difference?
Hardware and software interrupts.
Yeah, so basically, we can say that these are all basically hardware interrupts. So, we have dedicated pins for this particular interrupts. And at the same time, like you said, these have dedicated particular addresses also. That means vectored. So, and INTR is also vectored. It is not non-vector. But still, this is hardware interrupt. And this is having one pin. And but this one pin can go to multiple memory locations or multiple subroutines or ISRs, interrupt service routines. Okay. And that's why we call it, this is software interrupt. Okay. So this INTR will be going towards the 8085. This is an input signal like all other interrupts. So interrupts are input signal always. Okay. So when the 8085 receives interrupt INTR, because 8059 will provide the INTR to 8085, 8085 will send a so-called acknowledgement signal back to 8259, and that is INTA. Okay, whenever there is interrupt, the acknowledgement will be INTA. So the interrupt acknowledgement will be passed back to 8259. We will come to that also again. So there are 8 different interrupts. In all these interrupts are passed through INTR line of 8085. These interrupts can be resolved in using different priority levels. Remember this also. So when we have all these 8 devices, suppose simultaneously device number 4 and device number 2, they both want to communicate with 8085. So can they simultaneously use the data bus or address bus or any other features of 8085? No. At any time, 8085 or any other microprocessor is doing only one task, or it is just completing one task. If you break it down to the clock level, then you will find that in a particular clock, in one particular clock, the microprocessor or microcontroller, any other programming device, will be doing only one task. It cannot do 2 or 3 simultaneous tasks in the same clock. So definitely, device 2 and device 4 both requires 8085. But that does not mean 8085 can handle both of them simultaneously. At the same clock, he cannot give all the services to both the devices. So definitely, they will have to have priority. Okay? Priority will be given to both the devices. Suppose this device has got priority 0, assume, and this device has got priority 1. In that case, device 2 will be given first chance to communicate with 8085. And then at that time, the 8259 remembers that, okay, there was an interrupt from device 2 also. So he will remember, or he will keep a log, we can say, that device 4 also required the interrupt. So by the time 8085 finished the ISR, interrupt service routine of device 2, then after that, automatically 8259 will send another interrupt telling there was another interrupt from device 4 also. So 8259 can manage all the different interrupts which were occurred in between serving any other interrupt also. So he can manage all the these things. We will see how it actually manages those things. So he can resolve 8 different priority levels, because we are talking about 8 different interrupts. Okay. And at the same time, 8259 can mask each interrupt request individually also. So he can avoid or he can stop any particular device from sending interrupts also. So he can mask individual interrupts also. Okay. So when any interrupt is being served, like I said, device 2, suppose device 2's ISR are being served by 8085. Okay. Then the 8259 can read pending interrupts, status of pending interrupt, like now device 4 in this case is pending. So this is pending interrupt. So we can read the status of pending interrupts. We can read the status of in service interrupt. Right now device 2 is in service, so it is in service interrupt, and device 4's interrupt is pending, so it is pending interrupt. And suppose the 8259 said I will not give an interrupt to device 1, so masked, okay, it assume it is masking device 1. So we can read the status of all these three things. One is pending interrupt, which is not being served. Later it will be served, definitely. Secondly, the in-service interrupt, which is being served right now. Third is masked interrupts, which are avoided by 8259. Okay. Now, we can read the status of these three types of interrupts. Now, this device can get interrupts, or it can accept interrupts in different modes of triggering also. For example, it can accept level triggered interrupts at the same time as the triggered interrupts also. Okay, let us go back to this particular question. Out of RST 7.5, 6.5, 5.5 TRAP and INTR, which one is edge triggered? Which one is edge triggered? Which of these interrupts can be edge triggered?
RST 7.5 and TRAP.
So TRAP is edge triggered. It is level triggered. It is everything because it is non-maskable interrupt. So TRAP can come either in the form of edge triggering, or it can be even in the form of level triggering. So there is no question about that. RST 7.5 is edge triggered interrupt. So only an edge from the interrupt, or like this, just a pulse like this, a pulse going from low to high is enough to generate interrupt for 7.5. Okay. Rest of the interrupts like 6.5, 5.5, INTR, they are level triggered. That means they have to remain high for certain time period. This is level triggered. Okay, this is leveling. So they have to remain high on a particular level for certain time period. Only then the 8085 will listen to this particular interrupt. Okay, so 6.5, 5.5 and INTR are all level triggered. So this is level triggered. Okay, this is edge triggered. And remember, this is positive edge triggered. We are showing here positive edge triggered going from low to high. So 8259 can handle both the types of triggering. One is your level triggering or even the edge triggering interrupts. Now, when I said it can manage 8 different interrupts, we also said that it can be expanded to 64 priority levels by cascading. Now, what does that mean? It means we can cascade multiple 8259 ICs also. How many different ICs 8259 can be cascaded? 8. So, 8259 IC can be cascaded to generate maximum 64 different interrupts, or we can say we can connect maximum 64 different devices using 8259, but in this particular mode, cascaded mode. How this cascaded mode is designed, or how it is also called as in terms of circuit and all the programming, we will come to that also. Remember, if we are using 18259, we can handle 8 interrupts. But we can cascade or connect 8 different 8259s, and we can expand the number of devices to 64, because 8 into 8, 64 different devices can be connected. So when there are 64 devices, then definitely 64 priority levels will be there. For that, we will need cascading, and we will see how 8259 can be cascaded. So remember, 18259, 8 interrupts, but maximum we can connect 8259, okay, which will give us the flexibility to increase the number of interrupts up to 64. One more feature about this particular device is that it can work with 8086 and 8088 microprocessors, which are more advanced than 8085. So now let us go and see how this particular device is basically used. Any doubt in any of these particular points? Any devices, any doubt in these particular points? No. Okay. So we'll go to the next slide. So this is how we can connect the 8259 with 8085. Okay. So what are the features here? Remember, here we are using only one 8259. So when there is only one 8259, we can connect maximum 8 devices, because it can handle 8 different interrupts when there is only one 8259. So 8259's INTR will be connected to 8085. So see the arrow here, the direction of arrow. So this arrow is coming from 8259 and it is going towards 8085. So this is the arrows here. Okay. Now, in response to INTR, 8085 releases INTA or passes interrupt acknowledgement signal. And see the arrow here. It is generated by the 8085 and it goes towards 8259. So this is clear, very clear. Okay. So same INTR is an input signal, simple. Okay. INTR is an input signal for 8085 and INTA is an output signal. Whether you connect with 8259 or any other device, it does not matter. Now, at the same time, these buses, data buses, okay, we can call it, this is data bus basically, okay. So data bus is connected in bidirectional mode with the 8085 and 8259. So data bus is always bidirectional. So data can be read or data can be written also. And here we have devices ranging from D0 to D7, or we can say 8 different devices can be connected to 8259. And interrupts from these devices goes towards the 8259. You can see the direction of the arrow. So whenever these devices require any of the features from 8085, like data bus or sometimes calculation or something, in that case, these devices will communicate to 8259. And then 8259 will communicate with this microprocessor 8085, and in reply he will get INTA. So first this event will take place, event 1. When the device want to communicate with 8085, he will generate an interrupt. Okay. Interrupt will be generated by the device. This interrupt, when 8259 receives this interrupt, he will pass an INTR towards 8085. This is your second event. Okay. And when interrupt is received, remember 8085 finishes its current task or current opcode will be served. Then after that, he will release the third event that is your interrupt acknowledgement. And this is how, this is the basic design of interrupt controller. Okay, basic, very basic design. Okay, now let us come to the pin diagram of 8259. Every device will have its pin diagram, every device will have its own block diagram, every device will have its own architecture. And when I say architecture, then we will talk about the addresses, the control words, and then we will have to remember what the control words bits are, how this control word has to be written and all. Okay, that will define the modes in which the device will work. Simple. Now, first, let us talk about D0 to D7. Here you have D0 to D7. These are your data bus lines. So this will be connected to 8085. All these lines will be connected to 8085's data line D0 to D7. Clear. Then we have RD bar. Okay. RD bar, which is read operation. So if you can see here, there are two lines which can provide you read or write operations. That are these two lines, read and write operations are here. Okay. So when the 8085 wants to read or write something, he will use these lines to communicate with 8259. So remember, these two are both of these two lines are active low. So WR bar and RD bar, read or write. There is only one pin for the address, A0. Okay, whereas in the previous ICs like 8254 or 8255, there were two pins for the address. Here we have only one pin for the address, which is A0. Okay, only one pin for addressing. Rest, definitely when we are talking about addressing, definitely there will be one pin for the chip select that will decide the address of the chip. The address of the chip, okay? And then inside that chip, there will be one address depending on A0, okay? So, the chip select is here, which will decide the address of the chip itself, okay? So, this is always used, whether it is for it, it is not mandatory for it to find, and it is always with every IC that chip select is the, we can use the chip select to decode the address of the IC. Okay. Then we have three pins, CAS 0 to CAS 2. We can say that it is cascade 0 to cascade 2. Okay. So three pins are allowed for cascading. So here two pins are there, and then you have one pin here also, cascade 2. Okay. So cascade 0, 1, 2. These three pins are used when you are using this particular IC in cascade mode. When we use cascade mode, when we need to increase the number of interrupts from 8 to 64 or any other number in between. Okay, so when you are cascading multiple 8259, then you will have to use this particular three lines, cascade 0, cascade 1 and cascade 2. And now these three lines means three bits. So using three bits, you can access eight different devices. So in maximum, you can cascade eight different 8259 ICs. Okay, this is how you can correlate this also. So you have three pins for cascading. So three pins, you can use 000 to maximum 111. This is eight different combinations. Okay. So using these three pins, you can cascade when you are cascading multiple 8259, then these three pins will tell you which particular 8259 has to be served. We will see that later. Then we have SP slave, okay, slave program, and or we can call it enable bar. So EN bar. Okay. When it is high, when this particular pin is high, we will be using the slave program system, and when we are using low, then we are using enable. So both are bar. So slave enable, slave programming and enable both are the same pin. So that pin is here. Where is that pin? Slave here, SP or enable, slave program or enable. Slave program will be used when we'll be using the device as a slave. That means when we are using the device in cascade. Okay. When you are using the device as a master or in individual mode, you will be using only enable. What does that mean? It means, suppose we have the 8259. Here 8259. Suppose this particular device IC is working as master. When we are saying master, that means all the other ICs connected to the 8259 will be slaves. So again, you have 8259. This is 0, 8259, 1, 8259. 2, and similarly you can come up maximum, or you can connect maximum 8 to 5 9 7. So there are 8 different ICs, okay, cascaded together. So these are all your slaves, okay, and these are your, this is your master IC. So every IC will have its own enable 8259. Definitely every IC has got its own enable. And when we are using that enable line of master, we will be using enable. We will call it enable. And when we are using enable line from the slave, we will be calling it slave program. SP, 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 not these lines, okay, but we'll be using SP line. When you are using the enable in slave, we will call it SP or slave program. Okay. Now, then we have one line for the interrupt, which goes towards the 8085. So you have interrupt line INT. Sorry, INT here, INTR you can call it, or wait a second, you can call it INTR because INTR is going towards the 8085, or you can call it INT interrupt line also. So there is one interrupt line which goes towards the 8085. This is an output for this particular device and input for microprocessor. And in response, microprocessor will release interrupt acknowledge. Okay, that will be coming towards 8259. So this is input for 8259, but this pin is output for 8085, because this pin is like this, the arrow is like this, the signal is coming towards 8259. Here in this case, the signal is going towards 8085. So this is output or input for 8085, okay. Output for 8259 and input for 8085. So here you have 8085. Okay. Okay. And then, okay, this is done. Then you have 8 lines dedicated for interrupts. So 8 lines from 18 to 25, these lines are dedicated for interrupts only. So you can connect 8 different devices. Either you can connect 8 different hardware devices to these pins, or you can connect 8 different 8259 ICs with these particular lines. So it will become cascaded 8259. Okay, so these are your interrupt lines. Remember, these interrupts are asynchronous. What does that mean? When we say asynchronous interrupt input lines, What does that mean? Asynchronous. For any system, what asynchronous signifies?
Any does system not depend on the clock.
Yeah, it does not depend on the clock's occurrence, or it does not occur in sync with the clock. It is not necessary. For example, when we are having this kind of clock going on, okay. So interrupts can come at any part of the clock. It is not necessary interrupts will come only on the positive edge like this. These are the positive edge of your clocks or any particular signal. So these are positive edge. It is not necessary the interrupt will come either at positive edge or it will be coming between these events or levels, okay, or it will be coming at the negative edge. So it is not necessary that the interrupts will occur at any of this particular so-called events. It can come anytime. One interrupt can come here, interrupt can come here, interrupt can come here, or interrupt can come here. So anywhere, does not matter. So this is called asynchronous. Asynchronous. ठीक है. Asynchronous means there is no sync. And when we say sync, sync is with respect to time. Synchronized with something. Synchronization is with whom? In this case, in our system, the main clock is your event decider, when the event will take place. So in sync with that clock, no, interrupts are not synchronized with the clock. They can come at any time. And so that means when you are pressing a key, when you are trying to provide any input to the microprocessor, in that case the user do not know the microprocessor is at this particular part of the clock or this part of the clock or this part of the clock. So he can press the switch or any other device can provide any input at any time of the clock. So therefore they are asynchronous in nature. So they don't have to check what is the state of the clock. They can come at any time. Okay. So this was the pin diagram of 8259. Now, how the INTA is generated and what is the cycle of INTA interrupt? It is very clear. We have discussed it in very detail in the past also. Okay. You know that INTA signal is asserted by the interrupt controller, which is driven by the device's demanding interrupt from MPU. So when the interrupt controller or any other device, when it tries to interrupt microprocessor, INTA signal is generated by the interrupt towards the interrupt controller IC or any other peripheral which is demanding the interrupt. Okay. MPU and interrupt controller can have handshaking in hardware. So there can be handshake signals which can come or which can take place between the interrupts also. Leave it, not that important. Interrupt controller IC, which so interrupt controller IC, in our case it is 8259, of course it knows which device is causing the INTR. Remember, there is only one INTR. Okay, 8259, and there are multiple IN interrupt request. Okay, so you have IR0, interrupt request 0 to interrupt request 7. So there are 8 interrupt requests, but there is only one interrupt line which goes to 8085. Okay, So only one INTR line is there, and there are multiple IR interrupt requests. So 8259 have to make a record, or he should know which interrupt is being served. For example, if interrupt is requested by IR4, interrupt request 4, or device which is connected to this pin is requiring an interrupt from 80, or it is passing an interrupt to 8085. In that case, 8259 must have the knowledge of which device is being served. Okay, it is not that interrupt will be generated by IR4 and when serving the interrupt, the 8259 will serve IR0. It is not okay, it is wrong. So when interrupt is coming from a particular device, 8259 must remember or know, it should know which device has caused the INTR, because there is only one INTR. It does not have INTR0, INTR7 or so something. It has got only one INTR. So he must know, 8259 must know which interrupt is being served. Okay. We will come to that, how we can know which interrupt is being served. Okay. Interrupt control signals the microprocessor with a unique interrupt associated. Leave it. Okay. When interrupt is generated, the microprocessor will go to a particular interrupt service routine to execute or to serve a particular interrupt. So definitely when there are multiple interrupts, then definitely in the memory there will be a location for each interrupt service routine. So suppose ISR0, definitely there will be ISR4 and then ISR7. So you remember 8085 do not have any memory, so he will be using a memory, or we can say the ROM. Okay, he will communicate with the ROM, and which ranges from 0000 to FFFFH, right? So we know that whenever there is an interrupt coming, the interrupt is handled in the zero page, page number zero only. So there will be a location where you will have interrupt service routine for 0 and interrupt service routine for 7 or so on. You have to write small programs for each interrupt in that particular location. So when any interrupt takes place, 8259 communicates to 8085. 8085 informs the 8259 about the acknowledgement, okay, INTA. And then the microprocessor goes to a particular location for particular interrupt, which is the interrupt service routine's address. Okay, so this is all the things that takes place when we are generating, or any device is generating interrupt. Any doubt in this part or in this slide?
Sir, how does 8085 know that at which memory location it has to go? Because sir, INTR.
No, we will come to that. Don't worry. We'll come to that. INTR is, that's why I said only one INTR is there. So how does 8085 know which where to go? We will come to that. There will be total specification of each and everything. Then and only then that particular interrupt service routine can be served. We will come to that. 8085 will decode how it will decode. We will come to that. Okay. Clear? So now this is clear. So you have INTR going towards 8085. This is INTA. Wait a second. I have to modify this. Okay. So when interrupt is generated, it is generated from the hardware device. You have the, interrupt from the devices. Okay. So 8259 has got 8 interrupt requests. So IR0 to IR7. and we can connect our devices to those pins. Okay, devices like keypad, printer, whatever you like. And then INTR goes towards 8085, INTA come towards the PIC or 8259. Okay. And then the data bus is connected to the data buses of 8085, and definitely there will be some control signals also. So this is all about the basic controller. Now, when you are connecting this device 8259 in cascaded mode, when you want to connect this device into cascaded mode, this will be the scenario. So master IC, master PIC, our programmable interrupt controller, will be connected to different slave ICs. So IC number one and so on, we will have IC number two, or we can even have some pins dedicated for slaves and some pins connected directly to the hardware device also. What does that mean? It means you can have one scenario in which you have 8259 and you have IR0, IR1, IR2 and so on. So you can connect second 8259, you can connect another 8259, and remember all these 8259 has got its own IRs. So it will have IR0 to IR7. Similarly, this one also IR0 to IR7. So, okay. So, in this way, you can have multiple 8259s, and these are all slaves. And this is your master. Okay. So, 8259. Okay, so in this way, you can have all the 8 pins connected to 8259. Okay, otherwise, what you can do is you can even connect only few 8259s and rest of the pins can be directly connected to the device itself. Like here, 8259 is connected to, suppose here we have slave 8251. Slave 8259 2, but then what you did, you just directly connected device 1, device 2, so 28259, and so you can have maximum up to 6 devices which you can connect further. So 6 devices and 28259. You can have this combination. You can go with the permutation combination according to your choice. So in total, in this case, you will have 3 interrupts from, sorry. Wait a second. In this case, you will have 3 interrupts from the device directly. Okay. And rest, for example, you are using 28259. So here you have 8 interrupts and then 8 interrupts from here. So in total,
sir, we are using the pins cascade 1, 2, and 3 for connecting other 8259. So why can we connect only 6 devices? The IR pins are still free.
No. Wait. This is IR0, IR1. And here you have IR7. Okay. So 0 to 7. So definitely you can connect only one particular IC or device to one pin. You cannot connect, because here you cannot have multiple pins. Only one pin is there. So you connect one device.
Sir, but in the previous slide, it was written that we use cascade pins, not IR pins, to connect other 8259.
Wait a second. First listen to this and then we will go back to that. So, okay. So 8 from this device, 8 from this device, 16 plus 3, 21, sorry, 16 plus 3, 19 total device, IRQs can be generated with this combination shown in the right. Okay. Let us go back and see what the doubt is. Where it is showing? we have cascade here?
Sir, in the pin diagram.
In the pin diagram, cascade 0, 1, 2, cas 0, 1, 2 is with this particular, each device has got cas 0, 1, 2. Here this slave also has got cas 0, cas 1 and cas 2. Okay. Here also this particular IC also has got cas 0, cas 1 and cas 2. Okay. What is the use of this cas pin? That is more important. You are confusing with this particular pin. This pin tells which particular cascaded IC's request is being served. Because these three pin can have 8 different combinations, 0, 0, 0 to 1, 1, 1. So by putting signals on different or appropriate signals on this pin, we can select which slave has to be served. When I am saying like that, then in that case, you have your 8 to 5, 9 here, which I am assuming to be the master. And you have three pins, cas 0, cas 1, and cas 2. When you are using these three pins, so assume you put 1, 0, 1 in this particular cas 0, 1, 2. So that means you are focusing on the fifth pin. So IR 5 will be pointed by these three devices. But in IR5, it is clear that using these three pins, we can know that there is no device connected to this particular pin, IR5. Rather, there is another slave 8259 connected here, and which has got again IR0 to IR7. So, this is how CAS 0, 1, 2 are used. It is not that you connect 8259 in these pins. 8259 is not connected with these pins. These pins tell you which particular pin has got slave or cascaded 8259. Okay. Not, you do not connect 8259 here. It is not possible. You connect 8259 with the IR0 to IR7. And these three pins tells you which particular pin has got cascaded 8259. Clear? We'll come to that later. Don't worry. So, okay. So, master PIC is there. Then you have IR0. So, here you have IR0 which is connected to slave PIC. And similarly, you can have IR7 which is connected to a device direct. So, you can have different combinations of using. So, when you are having a slave PIC, then you have interrupt signals from the device which are here. IR0 to IR7 from the slave, and which is connected to IR0 of the master. Similarly, IR1 can have another slave which will here have IR1 which will be connected further to slave IC, which is IR0 to IR7. Okay, depends on your choice of designing the system. I had discussed it in the previous slide. Okay, now you can have this kind of interfaces where you have the 8259, it is connected directly to the hardware, or 8259, okay, 8259 which is connected to slave ICs, and you can connect 8 different slave ICs. Why? Because IR0 to IR7, there are 8 pins, you can connect 8 slave ICs And when you connect 8 slave ICs, each slave IC has got IR0 to IR7, which is eight different combinations. So 8 into 8 will give you 64 maximum, up to 64 devices can be connected to the 8259 combination if it is in cascade. Otherwise, if you are not using cascade, you can directly connect 8 different devices. Okay. Now, let us see how the 8259 manages these interrupts and try to understand the block diagram, what are there inside the 8259 and how the things are managed in a proper way. Okay, which might be a bit complicated in the beginning, but if you understand or try to go through it, it is not that difficult. So, we are talking about the block diagram. So, this IR0 to IR7, these are interrupt requests which are coming from the hardware or external hardware or maybe even slave ICs. But assume, let us assume here we are talking about eight different devices. So, these different interrupt requests are directly connected to one of the registers of 8259. That register is interrupt request register. So this particular register keeps a log, or you can say it maintains the request which it has received. Okay. So first, whenever a device needs an interrupt or needs an interrupt, that interrupt is directly communicated to one register called IRR, which is interrupt request register. When any interrupt occurs, then this interrupt request register informs the second block, which is priority resolver. Why it has to communicate with priority resolver? Because suppose simultaneously IR0 and IR5 took place. Okay, simultaneously these two interrupts came to existence. In that case, he will have to inform the priority request, look, there are two interrupts which are coming to me, IR0 and IR5. And now the priority resolver's job is to give or to check which of these two interrupts have got higher priority. So basically, IR0 has got higher priority. Okay, higher priority. So anyway, remember IR0 has always the highest priority, IR7 is the lowest priority in any microcontroller. Most of the microcontroller or any microprocessor, if you see, always the interrupt 0 is given the highest priority, and interrupt, whichever interrupt 7 or interrupt 64, it does not matter. So IR0 is the highest priority and lowest will be the biggest number. So in interrupt request, the highest number is the lowest priority. So IR0 is highest priority. So priority resolver will resolve this priority and he will serve this particular priority only, interrupt only, IR0. So that means in service register will get the information that he has to serve IR0 only. Now the question is, what happens to IR5 in that case? Because IR5 in that case will be neglected. But no, IR5 is not neglected. We will come to that. So the priority resolver will inform the control logic of the 8259. And the control logic will send an interrupt to 8085. Okay. And the 8085 will acknowledge the interrupt by passing INTA. Okay. Towards the 8259. So remember, these two lines are connected with 8085. And then these informations can be read. These informations or the status of these three registers, the IRR and ISR and priority, which priority is being served and all, this can be read as a status by the microprocessor also. So these all these lines are connected using 8-bit data buffer also, or data bus also. So whichever line that you are seeing brown are all data lines. So all are 8-bit. Okay. So, and these are all single bit, 1-bit signals. These are all 1-bit signals. These black lines are 1-bit signal. Rest are all 8-bit signals. And then control logic can be controlled by using this particular read, write, and A0. So A0 will tell you the address. We will decode the address from that. At the same time, we can decode the address by chip select also. So chip select will decode the address of the 8259. A0 will select the address inside the 8259. We will come to that, which address we are talking about. And other than that, control logic has got read and write operations. At the same time, control logic is also connected to one of the block called cascade buffer or comparator. Okay, so cascade buffer has got three pins, CAS0, CAS1, CAS2. Okay, these three pins can provide control logic to the system, or we can put slave program or enable the cascade logic if you are using the cascade. When you are not using the cascaded system, then you can avoid this block. There is no need to go through this block. Okay. Otherwise, when you are using cascaded system, then this block comes to play. Now the question was, here IR0 is being served in this case. So what happens to IR5? So IR5 is now a pending interrupt. Okay. So pending interrupt can be resolved later. At the same time, you can have one more register called interrupt mask register, which records those interrupt which has been masked or which has been avoided. Okay. So this information are read by the IRR, ISR and priority resolver before giving the controls to that particular interrupt. He checks whether interrupt has to be masked or not. If it is masked, don't give him the interrupt. Okay. If it is not masked, then go resolve that interrupt, resolve the priority, and whichever interrupt is being served will be recorded in ISR register that, okay, this particular interrupt is being served. And control logic handles interrupt towards 8085 in acknowledgement from the 8085. Read or write operation from the 8085 and A0 from the 8085, chip select from the chip select circuit. And then if it is cascaded, then this particular block comes to play. Otherwise, if we do not have cascaded ICs, then don't have to worry about cascade buffer or cascade lines. Okay. So this is the internal block diagram of 8259. So basically you can see here 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 blocks are there. Okay. Okay. If you look into the block diagram, then you have D0 to D7 data lines, which are connected to 8085, read and write logic, which are connected to 8085, cascading pins, cascade 0, 1, 2. Okay. If you want to use cascading, then you have three important registers, in service register, that means which of the interrupt is being served will be registered here. That presently, at present, this particular interrupt is served. Interrupt request register, which actually registers the interrupt whichever is coming from the device, which interrupt is coming from which device. So this register will register that thing, or it is a log file kind of thing, which will keep a log of all the requests which are coming. Then interrupt mask register, this will store the details of those interrupts which are being masked, which are not to be served. And then of course you will have a priority resolver, which will resolve the priority before giving, before sending interrupt signal to 8085. Then control logic has got INTR and INTA. These are the two interrupts lines which are connected to 8085. Okay, up to this, things are almost clear. Now we are going to get into the 8259's working. How 8259 can be initialized, how it can be programmed, and when programmed, how this particular IC behaves in a particular way. Till now, we studied what are there inside 8259. What are the things 8259 can do for us? Now we are going to see how to use 8259 or how to initialize and make it work in that particular fashion. So interrupt operation, or you can say operation or working of 8259. Okay, so to implement 8259 or to use 8259, there are two control command words. Okay, two control command words. So you have to manage these two control command words when you are using 8259s. Which are those control command words? One is initialization command word. By the name itself, you can understand this is to initialize the interrupt. How you are going to initialize the interrupt routine. Then operational command word. Operational command word means how that interrupt will be served. One, how to initialize, which interrupt is going to be initialized and all those stuff. And then second, how to manage those, or we can say it is managed. Okay, how to, not managed, how to manage those interrupts. Okay. So this is one is initialize the 8259. Okay, and then how to manage the 8259 at different time. Okay, so things that you have to keep in mind. So ICWs, initialization command words, are used to set up proper conditions and specify RST vector address to start the operation. Okay, you have to fill particular bits in this particular initialization command word. Then after that, that means first you will fill the initialization command word, then you will fill the operational command word, and then only the IC will start working. So second is operational command word. It is used to control the functions such as masking the interrupt, setting status, whether you want to read the status or not, and all those stuffs during the operation, how you are going to use that particular IC. First is to start that IC. Second is to run that IC. If you correlate with a motorcycle or a car or something, then you can call it, this is just to, before applying the key into the car, what are the things to be managed? Okay, what you have to keep in mind before triggering the key of a car or a motorcycle. Second, then after the, when the motorcycle has been started, or if the car has been started, then how to use the car or manage different stages of running. Okay, so how can you correlate? For example, it is not that you put the key and just rotate it and it will start. No, before putting the key and starting the vehicle, few things that you have to keep in mind, like you have to press the brake. Okay, the accelerator should be minimum, the handbrake should be released, and then you can rotate the key. Okay, otherwise if you are just so, and you have to keep the gear in the neutral, then only you should start the key. And otherwise, one more detail, that the clutch must be pressed. It is not that you just put the key and rotate it. It is not going to start in that fashion. For that, before rotating the key or before starting the engine, you must have to have some precautionary measures to be taken place, like the handbrake should be released, the clutch should be pressed, the gear should be neutral, and then only you should start the key or you should start the car, and brake must be pressed. Okay, so when you start the car, after that the car just started. Now the question is how you are going to run the car. Then you will have to, after starting the car, you have to go through different stages. Like, you do not put the fourth gear in the beginning. The first, you will have to put the first gear, take some acceleration, then second gear, then third gear, and so on. And there is also some rules to put the gears also, at what time or at what acceleration you should put the first gear. And when you are applying the gear, what are the things to keep in mind, whether you have to press the clutch or not, all those stuffs. So these are we can correlate these two with the ICWs and OCWs. ICWs, before getting into the interrupt service and all those stuffs, how to manage those things. OCW, when the interrupt has been started, how to perform all the functions of masking, setting the status, reading the status, and all those stuffs. Okay. So now, keeping in mind, there are two command words that you have to manage. Now, it is quite, now from here you have to keep everything in mind. Okay. So how the sequence of events takes place in 8.0.8.2.5.9 and how 8.2.5.9 completes a particular interrupt. First, the interrupt will be generated at one of these pins, IR0 to IR7. Okay. So first interrupt comes to the device or 8.2.5.9. So when interrupt is received by 8.2.5.9, that particular interrupts are registered into IRRR. Okay, IRR. So interrupt request register maintains that request. Then 8.2.5.9 evaluates this interrupt means whether this interrupt has been masked or not, or what is the priority of that interrupt. So 8.2.5.9 first check these things, and then when find appropriate that, okay, this interrupt is not masked or this interrupt is having the highest priority, then it starts or it sends an interrupt signal to 8.0.8.5. Clear? Then in acknowledgement, 8.0.8.5 sends INTA pulse. Okay, that is interrupt acknowledgement from the 8.0.8.5 side. Now, after receiving this particular interrupt acknowledgement, okay, remember, when the interrupt acknowledge is received, 8.2.5.9 has to go to certain vector location. Now, 8.2.5.9 has to tell where is that location for the ISR. So, for example, if IR3 is generated, so now corresponding to IR3, there will be a location in the memory like 0000 to FFFF. And we know that interrupt service routines are written in 0th page. Okay. That means the maximum address for interrupt is between 0000 to 0FFFH. This is 0th page. So now question is, you must have to write an ISR for ISR3, okay, for the interrupt 3. So when interrupt 3 is received and when the 8.2.5.9 found that it is appropriate, it is legal to receive to get into the interrupt request, then in that case, when he receives acknowledgement, 8.2.5.9 receives acknowledgement, he has to generate a call. Why the call? Because he has to reach to this particular address, right? So remember, first interrupt came, interrupt acknowledgement came. So 8.2.5.8.0.8.5 8259. And suppose IR3 came. Okay. IR3 interrupted the system. And 8259 find that, okay, IR3 can be served. So he sent an interrupt INTR to 8085. In response, 8085 sent an interrupt, INTA, interrupt acknowledgement. This is your first interrupt acknowledgement. Now, this is this thing you have to remember. So, interrupt acknowledgement, when 8259 received, then 8259 has to know where to go, where this address is for that particular interrupt service routine. For that, 8259 will release a call instruction. Definitely a call instruction will be released. And he will load 8-bit data onto the bus of data bus. So now you have the data bus. Okay. Data bus. But remember, data bus is 8-bit. Right? And database bus is 8-bit. But we have to reach to an address between 0000 to FFFFH. So we have to have 16-bit address. But the problem is, we have only 8-bit data bus. So now what the 8259 will do is, when he receives the first interrupt acknowledgement, he will use the 8-bit data bus to load the address of that particular ISR. So suppose ISR3 is written, assume it is written at 0030H. This is the address for ISR3. Now, in the beginning, when 8259 received interrupt acknowledgement, first interrupt acknowledgement, then after that he will have the access of 8-bit data bus, he will load the 16-bit address in two sequences. Okay, because 8-bit, first he will send first 8-bit, then he will send second 8-bit, and that combined two 8-bits will make it 16-bit, and that 16-bit address then will be fetched by the 8085. Okay, so that means now there are two more events left. One is to send the lower significant byte, and then to send the higher significant byte to reach to this particular address. For that, 8259 uses the call instruction, and there will be two more INTAs, INTA2 and then INTA3. Okay, in these two INTA, 8259 generates 16-bit address or passes 16-bit address in a chunk of 8-bit and 8-bit. So the data bus will be used two times to reach to that particular address. Okay. So remember, when the CPU sends INTA, okay, CPU, when we are saying 8085, when 8085 sends INTA to 8259, then 8259 will release a call instruction onto 8-bit data bus, which is having D7 to D0 pins. And now, how this particular thing is managed? The call instruction will initiate two more INTA pulses. Okay, so first interrupt acknowledgement was received. Then when the call is generated by the 8259, then there will be two more interrupt acknowledgements. Call instruction will initiate two more INTA pulses, INTA2 and INTA3, to be sent to 8259 from the 8085. So two more interrupts will come from 8085 towards 8259. And what will happen with those two interrupts? With those two interrupts, 8259 will first, in the second INTA when he receives, he will load the lower 8-bit address. And when the third INTA is received, then he loads the higher 8-bit for the interrupt service routine's address. Okay. I'm going to erase this all thing which I have been written. Okay. So done. So first interrupt acknowledgement was received to tell the 8259 that okay, microprocessor is ready to listen to you. Then after that, 8259 will generate a call instruction which will have two more INTA pulses. Okay, what will happen in those two INTA operations? In the first, that means in the second INTA, lower 8-bit address is released at the second INTA, and then third INTA when it receives, then it uses the higher 8-bit. So first lower 8 bit, then higher 8 bit. So combine these two, it will become 16 bit. That 16 bit tells the address for the ISR. Okay. So in this way, this completes the 3 byte call instruction received by 8, released by 8259. And then there will be a signal called automatic EOI end of interrupt. Okay, we will come to that in instruction also, AOI and EOI. Okay, so when that means that interrupt has been finished. Okay, so clear. Otherwise, ISR remains until EOI command is issued by the interrupt. Okay, so EOI, that means end of interrupt. There are two types of end of interrupt. One is AOI, A-E-O-I, and second one is E-O-I, end of interrupt or automatic end of interrupt. Now, it depends in which mode the particular IC is working. We have not talked about the modes yet. So, depending on that mode, there can be a signal automatic end of interrupt, which will be generated automatically, or end of interrupt, which has to be issued through the command itself. So this is how the sequence of events takes place in 8259 to complete a particular interrupt. Now we have to know what are the modes in which the interrupts can be generated, how many different modes are there and all those stuff. So please go through this later. After this, we will have to go through all the details. Like now you can see, wait a second, there are so many things that you will have to remember. The sequences of ICW, the sequences of OCW, how the ICW maintains all those stuff and all. So remember, this may become a bit more complicated at the later ages or later stages. Okay. But until unless you understand up to this part, or if you are not clear in any of these particular things, then you will find it very difficult to program 8259. Because 8259 is not that simple like 8254 or 8255. In here, the things have to be very clear. The sequences has to be very clear. Until unless you are very sure about what you are doing, you will end up with a wrong program. So you have to be very, very clear what this particular thing is going to do. Okay, it is not that simple to use 8259, remember. But it is not that difficult also, if you remember these things. So that's why I'm going a bit slow here. But if you have any doubts, okay, from these slides, we have covered only somewhere around 54. We have covered only 12 or 13 slides today. If you have any doubts, you can ask now.
Sir, where is the address of ISR stored in the 8259?